A very good evening to you and welcome to Ebru Africa Primetime News. My name is Michelle Morgan. It is, of course, the 19th of September 2014. Let's take a look now at stories coming up this hour.
President Uhuru Kenyatta today toured Kibera slum and launched the cleanup of informal settlements by the National Youth Service.
Across the regions, the highest level of rejection is in Central Province at 80%, 13% support it.
The latest Ipsos-Synovate survey indicates that over 50% of Kenyans are in fact opposed to the referendum. Nakumatt to hold a memorial ceremony outside Westgate on Sunday to commemorate the anniversary of the attack.
Ken OTP 0130-0507. It's at tab 27.
Submission of new evidence in the case against Deputy President William Ruto as the defense begins to cross-examine witness 23.
Deputy President William Ruto has today asked leaders to tone down on political rhetoric and focus on development. He added that it was time leaders put aside their political differences and embark on service delivery.
Speaking in Eldoret town when he flunked off a fleet of cars to be used by police in Uasin Gishu County in improving security, the deputy president said leaders should take a common stand in solving the problems facing the people.
It is a historic moment for us, and we stand at a historic moment to transform our country by working together and working in harmony so that we can create a nation that benefits all of us. Wakati tunasema tunapiga hatua ya kwenda mbele, hatutaki watu wengine wabaki nyuma. Tunataka tuende mbele pamoja.
The county governor took a jab on some of the governors who are calling for a referendum and asked leaders to embrace mutual respect so as to achieve development for the people, and that majority of the governors are opposed to the referendum.
Tunataka tuheshimu rais ya Kenya, naibu wa rais, na sisi wengine pia tutaheshimika kwa kuheshimu wengine. Na kwa hivyo tunataka tuungane. Na kuambia position yetu ni hakuna referendum. Mimi nasikia watu wengine wanasema Council of Governors. Hiyo ni Council B. Ile Council of Governors A, they are not supporting referendum. Hivyo mtu azienda kwa chukua akisema Council of Governors, hakuna kitu kama hiyo.
The deputy president directed that all vehicles donated to the county governments be surrendered to police or the government for proper utilization and coordination. 10 vehicles were handed over to the county.
A new survey released by Ipsos Kenya shows that 54% of Kenyans are opposed to the national referendum being pushed by the CORD coalition and the Council of Governors. Now, speaking during the poll release, lead researcher Tom Wolfe said most of those opposing the referendum calls mostly said it was because it was costly.
Retire from politics, support the referendum.
Research company Ipsos Kenya has released a new survey showing that most Kenyans are opposing the referendum agenda. According to the polls, 54% of Kenyans said they are against the referendum, while 38% drummed their support for it.
And as you can see at the moment, a clear majority of Kenyans are against a referendum, and only 38% want one as of now. We did not ask people to make a distinction between the two initiatives, because a month ago when we finished designing the questionnaire, we weren't even sure if the governors, they had been invited to State House to try to compromise. We thought that might be put aside.
The poll released on Friday morning shows that most of those against the referendum said it will be costly and has already been politicized. However, the 38% who are supporting it say they are rooting for an increase of funds down other counties.
Across the regions, the highest level of rejection is in Central Province at 80%, 13% support it. And the lowest level of rejection is in Nyanza, where 57% support it, but still far, far from everybody.
The polls conducted between the 24th of August and the 1st of September also shows that 69% of Kenyans support devolution, 26% more than those opposing the referendum calls. Most of the supporters cited a guaranteed equitable distribution of resources and increased public access to resources as their reasons for supporting it. However, 28% do not support devolution, with claims that politics has already taken center stage in the whole process.
Then we asked, why do you support devolution among those who do? The 76%. And the two most frequent answers we got, this was multiple response, a more equitable distribution of resources and better access of the public to these services. Only 2% couldn't give a reason. For those who oppose devolution, they're much more evenly divided, keeping in mind it was a multiple response, where slightly more than half says it's causing unnecessary political divisions, and at the same time, devolution is costing too much.
The referendum question has been on the spotlight for quite some time now, with the president and the Jubilee government opposing it, with claims that it will sum up to wastage of public funds. The CORD coalition, on the other hand, are going around the country collecting signatures as a way of drumming up support for the referendum that they initiated during the Saba Saba rally in July. This new survey by Ipsos Kenya has posed a challenge not only to the CORD coalition, but also to the Council of Governors, who are championing for a referendum, especially with the devolution question. Now, their work here is to convince Kenyans on why they need a referendum, especially now when most think it will lead to wastage of public funds in such times when high cost of living is a major worry. For Ebro Africa News, I am Akisa Wandera in Nairobi.
President Uhuru Kenyatta today met with ambassadors representing countries across Africa at State House in a move aimed at strengthening intra-African trade and enhancing the relationship between Kenya and other African nations.
Yeah? I have it.
Wonderful.
The head of state, together with the deputy president, held a friendly meeting with African ambassadors in Kenya to create a rapport that is expected to strengthen relationship between African countries and in turn enhance intra-African trade, as well as help solve common problems that the continent experiences.
And the people of this continent.
Uhuru said that it's time for Africa to stop depending on the rest of the world for help, but rather pull together the limited resources they have and work in solidarity to change the lives of the African people.
The only people who have an obligation to help is ourselves, and that is where we must begin. And we must begin to put our resources, no matter how scarce, into these joint efforts. We must begin to jointly work together on research, on things that affect us. We can't wait for people out there to come and give us a solution to malaria. Let us remove these imaginary boundaries and recognize that we are a people who share a lot in common and who have a destiny and a future together. Because Africa Rising is not going to be Africa Rising if any single one of us is left behind. We must pull together. We must work together and then enjoy the fruits and the successes of that effort together.
Ruto said that African countries should open up their borders, as that will go a long way in developing the economic potential of the African countries.
Borders that we have, they are not made by us. They are not our borders. We should instead turn these borders into bridges, not obstacles. For trade and people, should be bridges to connect us, connect our people, connect the businessmen, connect enterprise.
The African ambassadors and high commissioners acknowledged Kenya's effort in promoting intra-African trade and investment through the Standard Gauge Railway and Lapset project that is expected to immensely contribute in integration of economies of the countries in the region.
We are well aware of your sustained efforts to promote intra-African trade and investment. You have used your geographical position to support trade and investment initiatives in the East and Central African region.
This comes just a month after Uhuru visited the U.S. African Leaders Summit that sought to strengthen economic ties between Kenya and the U.S.
Learning was paralyzed in public universities after students went on strike to protest the delay of the release of their loans by the government. They blocked adjacent roads, demanding the immediate release of funds by the Higher Education Loans Board. Now, this comes after the Kenya University Students Organization had given the board an ultimatum of releasing the funds or hold a demonstration along the CBD.
The initially peaceful demonstration among the university students turned into a standoff with the police when they attempted to force their way into HELB offices at Anniversary Towers. The police fired tear gas to disperse the students who were hurling stones at them. Some of the students were caught on the wrong side of the law and defended themselves, saying they were walking past the demonstrations and were not involved in any way.
Mr. Kimbia, innocently they don't get it. I have a laptop. Can you call grab me the laptop, please?
Earlier this week, KUSO officials led by Babu Owino issued a strike notice to the board after a couple of pleas and calls to the HELB management saying most students were unable to start their classes due to lack of fees, which led to disharmony amongst them. While in Mombasa, more than 20 students from the Mombasa Polytechnic University were arrested after taking part in the demonstrations. The students have vowed to continue with these protests until all the money is released to their accounts.
After 3 hours of running battles between the university students and the police, finally, the police managed to clear off these students out of the streets. However, the students have vowed to continue with these riots until their demands are met. Reporting for Ebru Africa, I'm Dina Matengo in Nairobi.
The trial against Deputy President William Ruto saw yet another prosecution witness declared hostile. The prosecution sought the application on the grounds that the witness was impugning the prosecution's case. The defense, on the last day of trial this week, went to an extensive cross-examination with the prosecution witness at 23 as the prosecution made new documentary evidence submissions.
Your Honor, the 55...
The trial of Deputy President William Ruto at The Hague today saw the prosecution submit quite a docket of new documentary evidence to the court. Now, the defense started their cross-examination of the witness as defense counsel Hooper sought to dispute the existence of an ODM meeting following the December 20th gathering at Huduma Center in Kabarnet.
Can OTP 0130-0507, it's at tab 27. Can OTP 0130-0540, at tab 22. Can OTP 0130-0563 at tab 23, and can OTP 0130-0566 at tab 24.
The document KEN OTP 0114-0469 will bear the number MFI T OTP 00164.
The significant part of the trial today and this week has been spent in private session, contrary to the last week. But the trial this week has been relatively uneventful, as both the prosecution and defense have been deep in examination and cross-examination with the newest witness to take the stand.
To the prosecution.
Ruto and Sang are on trial on 3 counts of crimes against humanity, each for their alleged roles in the bloodshed that followed the December 2007 presidential poll.
President Uhuru Kenyatta today toured Kibera in Nairobi to launch the cleanup of informal settlements by the National Youth Service. He toured the cleanup exercise and committed to improve the living standards in the area.
The president, who was touched by the filthy situation in Kibera and other informal settlements, said the national and county governments will work together to improve the living conditions of inhabitants. He said the sanitation program undertaken by National Youth Service graduates will engage the local youth to develop and transform them into productive citizens. The president, who was accompanied by Devolution Cabinet Secretary Anne Weguru, Nairobi Governor Evans Kidero and National Youth Service Director Nelson Githenje, commended youth in the area for abandoning unlawful activities to engage in productive work. The president assured that the cleanup program will be rolled out to other areas to improve on sanitation in all parts of the country. President Kenyatta assured Kibera residents that the national and Nairobi county governments will work together to install street lighting in the slum. He promised to open up the roads cutting across the slum to enable residents to access services including firefighting equipment in case of fire.
Tutaendelea pia na mpangilio ambao tuko nao wa kuhakikisha ya kwamba hata pia street lighting na mambo mengine tutaweza kufanya. Na tuweze kufungua barabara zetu ndio ukiwa kama kuna emergency isiwe ya kwamba kama vile juzi watu wamechomewa na tutaenda kuwatembelea huko, isiwe ya kwamba wazima moto hawawezi kufika huko kwa sababu hakuna barabara na zimefungwa.
The governor welcomed the cleanup program, which he said would improve on sanitation in the slums besides creating employment for the youth.
Hii kazi ya kuleta usafi Kibera. Vijana wetu wa NYS, na mimi najua kuna wengine ambao wametoka hapa, ambao wamehitimu kutoka NYS. Na wengine pia wataenda.
The president once more urged leaders to work together in delivery of quality services to Kenyans.
Nominated MP Isaac Mwaura says Kenya needs to put in place stringent laws protecting albinos in the country. Mwaura says albinos need to be protected from the black market trade of their body parts, which are believed to have magical powers. Mwaura was speaking at the Thika School for the Blind, where he relocated Gabriel Kinanjui, who had been affected 3 times in Taita Taveta by child traffickers, with the aim of taking him to Tanzania for witchcraft practices.
Albinos in East Africa live in fear of witchcraft moneymakers. They look at every day as a challenge. It's a challenge to protect the skin from a merciless sun which can easily cause painful burning. But harder than all of those challenges is the daily challenge to stay alive in a society willing to murder albinos for profit. Albinos have been killed for their body parts that are then shipped out of the country for ritual purposes. The illegal trade has created fear among albinos in the country. Albinos are regularly being smuggled to Tanzania, where they are killed for their body parts.
Na hili jambo limekuwa limekithiri sana tangu mwaka 2007 na ni jambo la kutamausha sana. Sijui kwa nini watu wanamotisha wa kuweza kufanyia watu kama sisi vile. Na sisi pia sio watu ambao ni wa Mungu ambaye ni mchache kuliko miungu ile mingine yote. Sisi tumezaliwa kama wale wengine.
Since there are no laws or policies against witchcraft in any of the countries in East Africa, the demand for albino body parts continue unchecked. As a result, there is widespread panic and insecurity among people with albinism. Nominated Member of Parliament Isaac Mwaura says that people who harm albinos need to be taught a good lesson by the law. Mwaura is among some MPs under the Kenya Disability Parliamentary Association who are seeking to amend the Persons with Disability Act to propose stiffer penalties for such atrocities and protect albinos.
We do not have an East African law that criminalizes, that outlaws these kind of practices. So we would want the East African Legislative Assembly to pass a law in that regard and also to have policy statements, policy pronouncements by the 5 heads of East African states about this issue, because we've not had a collective pronouncement on this issue.
Across the board,
Gabriel Kinanjui is among albino children who have been a target for the black market.
Living in Taita Taveta with his parents and grandfather, child traffickers have been in several occasions trying to abduct him with an aim of taking him to Tanzania for witchcraft practice. And so every day, Gabriel would be escorted to and from school and be watched while playing.
Na yale mateso nimepata mimi kwa kubeba mishale, marungu, ni mengi. Sababu, ameenda mara tatu.
Hata nikiwa na huyo mtoto wangu shambani siendi. Hakuna mahali naenda, nikimpeleka shuleni asubuhi, saa saba nimrudie.
Maana, hii tulikuwa tulali, sisi tunamlinda kwa mishale. Ndio, angalao tunajua kwamba sasa hatuna kinga ingine ambayo tunaweza kujikinga nayo.
Today, Gabriel felt a sigh of relief as he walked into the compound of Thika School for the Blind, where he had been relocated by the Albinism Society of Kenya for safety and learning purposes.
Na kumpeleka nyumbani hata hakuna nafasi ya kuweza kuenda kutafuta chakula, ni kumulinda ule mtoto, maana ujui kwamba hao watu ambao watoka Tanzania wanatafuta albino watakuja saa ngapi, ama saa yote wewe unakaa na uoga. Kwa hivyo mimi nashukuru hivi leo tutalala usingizi, kwa maana mtoto atakuwa mahali pa usalama.
Mwaura regrets that the Thika School for the Blind is poorly funded and cannot adequately provide all the purpose that people with albinism need in order to live their lives with dignity. He also wants the government to establish a rescue center for albinos who are running from their community due to insecurity.
But we need a dedicated rescue center for children with albinism, for adults with albinism, who either are attacked or are ostracized, where they can come and get refuge. It's good that this is a child who can come to this school. What if it was an adult? Where would they have gone to?
Well, this is a place where Gabriel will call home for the next 8 years, a place where he will feel loved and protected from the people who wanted to abduct him and take him to Tanzania for cultural practices. And now the East African community has the mandate to put up stringent measures that will protect children such as Gabriel from the abductors. For Ebru Africa TV, I'm Brenda Zeda at the Thika School for the Blind in Thika.
Kenya will mark 1 year since the Westgate terror attack on Sunday. Regional retailer Nakumat Holdings will spearhead the memorial. A memorial candle will be lit outside the Westgate shopping mall at 12 noon on Sunday, a day that is coincidentally the World Peace Day.
Interdenominational religious prayers will be held across all the Nakumat supermarkets across East Africa. According to Nakumat Holdings Managing Director Atul Shah, the supermarket will commence prayers at 9 a.m. on Sunday. A moment of silence will also be observed where staffers will light a memorial candle outside the Westgate shopping mall at noon. Earlier this week, the First Lady Margaret Kenyatta attended the opening of a two-month-long exhibition in memory of the victims and survivors of the Westgate shopping mall terrorist attack, where she expressed solidarity with those who lost their loved ones in the attack and said that such heinous attacks will not break the spirit of Kenyans. The exhibition was put together by a filmmaker by the name Arjun Kohli. He has also put together video testimonials from bereaved families, survivors and hospital staff. A special website, www.westgatememorial.org, has also been set up for the memorial. All these activities will culminate to a moment of reflection, healing and, more importantly, forgiving. The horror, the pain and the tears on that fateful day brings back memories of one of the darkest days in Kenyan history. Now, the family members who lost their loved ones and the hundreds of victims on that fateful day will be joined in by millions of other Kenyans in observing moments of silence in remembrance of the over 60 lives that were lost. Reporting for Ebru Africa in Nairobi, I'm Sam Gakunyi.
With almost 76,000 Nigerian Muslims expected this year at the Taj in Saudi Arabia, Nigerian authorities have put in place extra security measures to allay fears that pilgrims would spread Ebola outside the region. According to Saudi authorities, the 2 million people are expected at the Hajj next month, and more than 6,000 pilgrims have been checked by the operation backed by the World Health Organization and approved for travel in Lagos so far.
Nigeria is the only country of the five in the region affected by the mass outbreak of hemorrhagic fever that has been given permission to send its pilgrims to Mecca for the world's largest gathering of Muslims. At the Hajj cargo terminal at Murtala Muhammad International Airport in Lagos and at other departure points across the country, that means a three-tier health screening check before they are even allowed to board the plane.
The idea behind the screening of all passengers in and out of Nigeria is basically to make sure that, one, Nigeria does not export any case to any country, and at the same time we do not import any case. So it's part of that overall role that Nigeria is playing in trying to make sure that this does not become a problem. That's why the Port Hajj screening is going on.
Port Health Authority used contactless thermometers to check the travelers' temperatures. Fever is one of the symptoms of the virus.
We have in strategic places running water with soap for all pilgrims to always wash their hands. Very simple hygiene rules, and we ensure that that is done. And we also encourage those who can afford it to take sanitizers if they can, and wet wipes.
One pilgrim, Afolabi Inabo, said she was sure the measures would work.
No, Ebola cannot spread because we have sanitizers to wash our hands, we have soap, we have masks, we have gloves that we use. So Ebola cannot spread in this area.
Some 35,000 pilgrims have already undergone the same procedure, while both the state and federal governments in Nigeria have carried out health checks even before the pilgrims get on the bus. Nigeria has been widely praised for its response to Ebola, despite initial fears that the virus could spread like wildfire in the crowded megacity of Lagos, where the first case was detected in July.
The UN Security Council has declared Ebola a threat to international peace and security and adopted a resolution calling on states to provide more resources to combat the outbreak. UN Secretary General Ban Ki-moon said he will create a special mission to combat the disease and deployed staff to the worst affected areas.
United Nations Secretary General Ban Ki-moon warned an emergency meeting of the Council that the number of Ebola infections was doubling every 3 weeks. More than 2,600 people have now died in the worst Ebola outbreak on record. The resolution attracted 130 co-sponsors, a United Nations record, and calls on countries to provide urgent aid, such as medical staff and field hospitals, and urged travel bans imposed by some states to be lifted, saying the countries need to have access to aid instead of being isolated. Elsewhere, officials in Guinea have found several bodies as they were searching for a team of health workers and journalists who went missing while trying to raise awareness on Ebola. The aim of the move is to keep people confined to their homes while health workers isolate new cases and prevent Ebola from spreading further. Critics say the lockdown will destroy trust between doctors and the public. Meanwhile, a British nurse who recovered from Ebola has traveled to the United States to donate blood to try to save the life of another victim of the virus. As a survivor of the disease, the nurse could help the victim recover by donating his blood, which will now contain natural antibodies that can help protect against Ebola.
It is now time for a short break, but don't go too far. Still to come. Scotland votes to remain part of the United Kingdom. We bring you reactions and sentiments from both sides. And a suicide bomb attack in Baghdad kills 16. All the details coming up.